Hello, everybody. This is Daniel Wang again. We're here in Berlin. We're doing the series Talking Dance Music with Electronic Beats. And I'm happy to be able to present to you another record from my collection, which some of you might know. And and talk a little bit about its history and some of the ideas and stories behind it. Actually, it's two records, we could say. The first record is a record that I bought when I was living in San Francisco around 1991, 1992. I'd go around Castro Street, where there are gay bars and record shops, and I found this interesting import from the UK. It says, By Daylight here, that was the A side, and the B side here, Hope. Right away, it had a very interesting sound. It looked like a New York bootleg. It says JPR Records. Only later I learned that this record was produced by a guy named Phil Asher in London, who was also known for introducing the broken beat genre and other things. He passed away a few years ago. He was a friend of mine and a real idealist. When he made this record, it was about 30 years ago now, it simply made me curious. There's this interesting groove with a kind of mechanical 101 or Roland, you know, a 303. Acid bass line, and it sounded kind of like this. Okay, so here's, first of all, I kind of just like the groove. I had another DJ friend, couple back then, and we all found this record really interesting, but and at the time, we didn't know where this sound came from. It didn't sound like the other house music records we were hearing from New York in the early 90s. It took me a few years to really find out what the original was, and this is the main record we're talking about. The original groove for that record, that funny little 303 groove or 101 groove, is actually this. And this is by the band Maze, featuring Frankie Beverly. Maze. A side was Too Many Games, and the B side was this track called Twilight. And so this is the original, released on Capitol Records from the US in 1985. So on the bootleg, it sounded a bit different. Phil Asher, the producer, had added a more heavy kick drum, I think from an 808. But as soon as I heard this original, of course, I was quite entranced by it. It has a very lovely, meditative, kind of beautiful, spiritual kind of sound to it. And then started asking friends about this. And of course, another interesting thing to say is, originally Maze, as you may know, is pretty much known as a, more or less in the US at least, as an R&B band male voice, Frankie Beverly. They had a couple hits from 1980, 1981. The most famous are Before I Let Go, and also the big hit Joy and Pain. Yeah, this is on a British compilation, Classic Mellow Master Cuts. It's really one of those huge anthems that everyone who goes to urban clubs in the US would know. It's considered a real classic. And sometimes you see the ones that you care for give you so much space. Oh, but it's all right. They're both one in the same. Okay. So that's the song, Joy and Pain. Speaking a lot about, you know, human experience, life is full of joy and pain, it's like sunshine and rain. But then, of course, there's a bit of a mystery here. So what is this record? This thing was released in 1985. As far as I know, it wasn't a huge hit, the A-side or the B-side. Nobody in the US, among my DJ friends or people who are into this, seemed to really know or care about it, but it was kind of a hit in the UK, it seems. And not only my friend Phil Asher had produced this bootleg version, in fact, the producer Goldie, known for drum and bass, had also sampled it in something which became a hit. I think I have it on CD right here. Let's give it a try. Switch it over to CD. Okay. So you can see, somehow this piece must have been considered interesting or hit or kind of influential in the UK scene, while in the US, it was largely forgotten. So what's going on? And furthermore, started thinking about it, it's kind of an exception because this is 1985. So when you think of R&B artists, you might think of Luther Vandross or Aretha Franklin or, you know, many of these Barry White. You don't think of these guys in the mid-80s, turning on a drum machine and an analog sequencer, making a kind of a minimalist electronic techno instrumental track out. They just didn't do that. Or if they ever did it, they didn't release it. But here's Maze, Frankie Beverly, releasing something which some people might say sounds like a proto-house or proto-techno, which in a way it is. And that in itself is kind of interesting. What was happening here? The production is very raw and very simple. It almost seems like Frankie Beverly put together a sketch, threw something together in his studio, and instead of self-censoring, instead of saying, oh, I need to release a standard pop song with verse and chorus and refrain, this thing has a nice sound. Why not just put it out as a B-side? So in a sense, that makes an interesting exception too, a kind of a, you know, real anomaly as far as records, and, you know, somewhere somebody liked it and kept on playing it and made it into a hit. Also, just like we did last time, it's kind of fun to reconstruct this track because it's based around such a simple, minimal idea. And we were saying, you know, at least in the US, we think of R&B music, we think of Aretha Franklin or Luther Vandross or, you know, so many greats. But when we think of Chicago house music or electronic music, we think of maybe DJ Pierre, Mr. Fingers, you know, Tyree Cooper, Adonis, all these things that are Chicago house from 1986, 1987, 1988, and beyond. And it's interesting that somehow there's this thing that sits between these two worlds, made by a credible R&B artist, but making something with a quite different mechanical, repetitive sound. So, of course, it's based around a repetition. We can start out by turning on the synthesizer. We can do it very simply on my little mini 101, SH01 here. Okay, let's play the record. So the bass, so we're in key of F. La da 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 da. Dun, 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 ba, dun, dun, bum, bum, bum. There's the key of F. I know you guys love this little pitch pipe that I always use. It's nice to know what key you're in. Okay, and then we program this bass line, which is quite simple, really. Press load here. Okay, and I've worked it out for you on paper. It's like last time, you know, it's just like a little funny Roland drum machine here. We've got 16 spots, spelled out the notes. Roughly, it would look like this. I think you can see this on the camera. It's a bass line is dun, 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 bum, 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 bum. Okay, we start out in the E flat. If we're thinking do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti, do, you know, the do, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, right? The do is the 1 and the 8. And in this case, that's the F. So we have 7, 8, 8, 8, 1, 3, 4, 3. So E flat, dun, 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 dun. And start out programming here. Start out with an E flat. F again. High F and then down to the low F. Okay, so we've got our 16 steps in there. Let's play it back. I think it worked out correctly. Okay, we've got the bass line. We can play with the filter a bit. You guys know this stuff. Can make it a little bassier. Tweak it up a bit. If we wanted to exaggerate the portamento, we could even do that. It's not going to sound very correct, but... you know, I mean, on a synthesizer with an analog sequencer, we have that possibility, right? Just a touch. Okay, so we have the bass line, and then the rest is keyboard decoration on the top. The drum pattern's repetitive, it's very simple. We go over there and play the ninth chord, and it's also interesting to discuss this ninth chord very quickly. What is a ninth chord? It's basically on the piano the 1, the 3, the 5, the 7, and the 9. Okay, and it's also interesting because we were saying Mays has this, one of their famous songs is Joy and Pain. And of course, a lot of the music, dance music, jazz, Afro, dance music comes from the Afro-American traditions where so much of the art, there is a lot of joy and there's a lot of pain too in people's daily lives. And what's interesting, I think, about these chords, these kind of seventh and ninth chords, which feature so heavily in jazz and blues music, less so in the classical European tradition, more so in the 20th century when jazz and blues come in, is they have a beautiful ambiguity about them. When you look at the way a minor seventh or a minor ninth chord is constructed, it's 1, 3, 5, 7, 9. It starts out with a minor, but you stack another, the seventh makes it a minor plus a major. When you add the ninth in the F, the ninth is the G, yeah? It adds another minor. So in other words, a minor seventh chord or minor ninth chord has a beautiful ambiguity. It's not like primary red or primary yellow color. It's like a blue plus a green. It's happy and sad at the same time. It's two different moods melding together in harmony. If you listen to Detroit techno, I'm sure you guys know what I mean. You hear this chord quite often, that beautiful ninth chord. It simply glides, and there's not much more you need to do with it. And also, when we talk about chords, of course, we talk about colors. And colors are frequencies on the electromagnetic spectrum. There's a question often in composing, you know, serious classical music, jazz music. Does something need to be complex or complicated to be beautiful? And my answer here is perhaps no. It depends on the situation, but so much of the dance music we enjoy, it's based on these repetitive, simple bass lines and rhythms underneath, and sometimes some very simple chords on top, but that leaves open space for us to improvise, to imagine. It's not a predetermined outcome like a Broadway musical or a clever Disney movie where you know exactly where to laugh and where to cry. When you're on the dance floor, you hear certain chords like blues and jazz. It's both emotions at the same time, and you're invited to participate. When we think of colors, some people ask me why I have these things in my living room, and you can look briefly. Perhaps you see the blue butterflies here. These are the morpho butterflies. I think they're mostly native to South America. And the point I'd like to make is when great jazz musicians and improvisatory musicians play, sometimes they speak about channeling some kind of reality from the universe. It's a kind of a cliche. They feel in their souls, in their heart, or they channel from beyond. But it's as if these rhythms and frequencies and emotions exist beyond us human, when we're merely calling them in. Is it not a little bit like the butterflies, in the sense that the butterflies are not creating this color blue? They are not blue by will or volition. In fact, these blue butterflies probably don't know that they are carrying this color blue. They simply became blue. They are blue as a phenomenon, a natural phenomenon, from reacting with vibrations and frequencies of the physical universe. How can we as humans be sure, so sure, that we are all creatures of free will, that all of our creations are merely deliberate, when sometimes the most beautiful things are perhaps things where we are reacting with and simply receiving vibrations and frequencies from the world around us? Maybe that's the connection between colors, frequencies, chords, and this kind of music that we enjoy so much. It's one way of describing. Okay, so now we've got the bassline programmed. You can see it's very simple, it's one measure. And then we can go over to this nice little Yamaha keyboard I have, and I can show you the very simple ninth chords and the sort of decorations that Frankie Beverly added on top to make this track, Twilight. I almost forgot to mention this. What's interesting is, even though Twilight, the piece on the record, is a synthesizer programmed jam, if you go on YouTube and you search this title, Maze Twilight Live, you'll see Frankie Beverly and his band playing this piece as a live acoustic set. I think it's in London, again, not in the US, but in the UK. I think at the Odeon around year 2013, 10 years ago. And it's really exciting to watch this, because you can hear how they took a very simple, repetitive idea in the bass, but the whole band is jamming with it. It's a live bass player playing the piece on his guitar, that bass line that we've recreated here. And it's also interesting to note, in the synthesizer, originally on the record, Frankie Beverly played it in F minor. But in the live jam, in this YouTube video, you see them shifting down half a semitone into E minor. I think probably because it's easier to keep an E minor bass line on a guitar. Guitar is easy to play, I think, in keys E and A. Yeah? It's sort of built around that. And you see them with guitar solos and lots of live percussion. They really stretch it out, and you see the audience dancing with them. It's really exciting. So again, for comparison's sake, it's interesting, it's educational. After listening to Maze Twilight on the record, look at the live version on YouTube and you can feel the difference and how you can take a simple idea and expand it also. I hope you enjoyed that segment that we presented this time about Twilight, this track by Maze and Frankie Beverly, with its own special little sound, perhaps a kind of exception in the era when it was created. And I hope you found it interesting, both on the level of sound as a piece of music, and maybe also from some of the concepts behind it.